Don't hit my head.
Amazing Spaces...
Do I look all right?
..is now 10 years old.
Fantastic.
Where the nation's small space trailblazers...
Way!
Left a bit in there.
..prove that with a little bit of skill...
There we go.
..and a whole load of heart...
It's off.
That is beautiful, that.
Anything is possible.
Oh, my word.
It's just out of this world.
And I travel to Israel.
Just look at that.
Where ancient history and culture meets cutting-edge design.
It's just breathtaking. One of the most eccentric but brilliant things I've ever seen.
And Max McMurdo and I...
If you jump...
Oh, yeah. Is that what it's like for you?
..build a brand-new caravan. Like you've never seen before.
Conceptually, it's utterly nuts.
And that's why we should do it.
So brace yourselves... ..for some seriously amazing spaces.
You might even be the greatest amazing space of all time.
This time...
Timber!
A farmer has a hoot...
Hang on, come back.
..building a hilltop cabin.
That's a nice touch.
Cool, isn't it?
A nice little cute little owl eyes on that.
Yeah.
Max and I get snap happy on our search for the perfect shade.
Fir green. Moss green. Done. Come on. Got a caravan to build.
And in Israel, it's always fun to stay at the YMCA.
Just look at this. It's breathtakingly beautiful.
During the 10 years of Amazing Spaces, many of the best builds I've seen... ..have been the kind of outrageous ideas that look like they were dreamed up by people in cloud cuckoo land.
And you could say that the build I'm going to see today is very cuckoo, because while the family are in the process of taking on one ambitious build, they've decided to do another.
Martin and Tracy are about to start building their dream home on their own farmland for themselves and their teenage daughters.
Everybody comes in after two. One, two.
But with that build yet to start and brass band practice taking priority, they're in dire need of extra emergency accommodation.
Good morning.
Morning.
How are you doing?
Welcome.
So nice to see you.
You too.
You've taken on this beautiful, very tired bus. How old is it?
It's 1965.
And why have you taken it on?
We've been waiting for planning for turning a barn on the site into our long-term home.
Where are you living now?
We've got two caravans that we're making do with, but we're a family of four and it's quite tight. We've got one tiny toilet and a tiny kitchen, so we're planning on hopefully using the bus for a bit of extra accommodation as well, extra space for the kids.
So is the caravan becoming a little bit cramped?
It is. Three of us are musicians, so if you're trying to practice in the same space all at the same time, it's a bit chaotic.
Crikey, that must be like the noisiest caravan in the world in there when they start.
Hence, I'll be going to the bus.
Can we have a closer look?
Yeah, absolutely.
Let's go. You've started work on the outside, so have you taken all the panels off?
All the panels virtually fell off.
I bet they did.
To be honest, because all of this woodwork was as rotten as anything.
So you've actually replaced a lot already.
This bus has led a varied life, been painted multiple times. But Tracy and Martin plan to return it to its original livery.
We've spoken to some enthusiasts and what have you, and we've got the exact colours.
You've spoken to some enthusiasts?
They were telling us stuff that we didn't know. They're like, oh, number so-and-so, oh, yes, so, you know, we know all about that.
Now, can I be a bit of a kind of... a bit of a geek and jump in the cab?
Yeah, go for it.
There you go. Probably go straight on there.
Yeah.
This cab is amazing.
It's packed with character. And what's this bit going to be when you convert it?
I'd like to clean it up just so it could be used for fun, for kids to sit in and pretend they're driving a bus kind of thing.
I don't... Like I'm doing now,
yeah,
you
exactly,
mean.
Yeah. Just for kids,
big
yeah.
Big kids.
Yeah.
Time to see what Martin and Tracy are starting off with.
So you've ripped all the seats out, you've cleaned it out as much as you can.
We have.
Fantastic space, isn't it? I mean, look at the scale and size of it.
And we wanted to keep these poles as well because we wanted to keep as many original type features as possible, so keeping the poles makes it quite nice.
Bought for £2,000, Martin and Tracy's double-decker conversion will give them extra room while they build their new home. And a cool place to hang out once it's done. Downstairs, they plan to build a spacious living area for the girls to hang out, plus a kitchen for refreshments and a small bathroom. Upstairs will be the dedicated sleeping quarters with a double bed at one end and bunk beds along the sides for when the kids host sleepovers.
So, how long is it going to take?
Well, we're hoping to get it done within about 3 months from now.
And how much are you hoping to do the build for?
We're hoping to get it in under about 10 grand.
That's a challenge. You've got your work cut out, but I'll see you soon. Take care.
Thank
Good
you.
Luck with it. Now, you've got to admire Tracy and Martin's ambition. They've taken on a very difficult project, and they want to get it completely finished for them and their kids in just 3 months. Jump aboard, everyone. It's going to be quite a ride.
Martin and Tracy aren't the only ones on a wild ride. To celebrate a decade of amazing spaces, Max and I are replacing my caravan from Series 1 by building a brand new one.
Now, ever since my old caravan was pulled away, I've been thinking, designing, and worrying about how the caravan can do everything that I need it to do. Well, it's time to go from imagination to reality. And Max and his team have made a fantastic start. Today, I'm at their workshop to check on progress and lend a hand.
George has also called and said he's been inspired. But what he's been inspired by is Carlisle Cathedral and the barrel vaulted ceilings, and now he wants them in his caravan. I've made a little prototype. I think it's kind of what he's talking about, and hopefully he'll say yes and we can start actually building this thing.
Max!
What do you think?
Man, it looks fantastic. Absolutely brilliant. Do you know what? It's great getting that first section of frame up because you can see what it's actually going to feel like.
Yeah, I must admit, when it first went up, I was shocked by how tall 3.6 metres really is.
Today, we're going to build the walls.
They're heavier than they look, these things.
So, first one in.
Using something called sit panels.
Is it? Quite heavy, aren't they?
That's super heavy. Sit panels. What does that stand for?
Structural stuff. Insulated panel.
Structurally insulated panel.
Yes. See, I knew. Do you want to do the screwing?
Yeah, thanks.
Go on. Lovely.
These clever panels come already pre-insulated, meaning they're super sustainable, and installing them should be a doddle.
I don't think it's straight.
Of course it's straight.
They're also robust enough to withstand moving the finished caravan onto the site.
This is when it'll get really strong, when the corner goes in. Shall I do this? I've got it.
Anybody on that gap?
I can't lift it up.
Can't do the top.
Can you do it? Perfect.
It's brilliant. And look at the amount of insulation there. It's unbelievable. It's going to be one of the warmest caravans in the world.
What do you think?
Great. Fantastic, that. Super strong.
Max has really nailed it with the structure so far, but I want to see if he's risen to the challenge of my cathedral-inspired barrel-vaulted ceiling.
So, Max, you've built kind of half a mock-up of the barrel-vaulted ceiling.
Yeah, and it was a lot of hard work just building that bit, let alone 36 feet of it. Can you imagine?
There's a slight problem, though.
It's my height, isn't it?
Yeah. I mean, talk about how to make the caravan feel even smaller.
Are you sure you want this? Look at the beautiful square-pitched roof. That looks glorious. And a lot easier for us to build.
This is the most important part of the build, Matt. Outside, you think it's this very simple pitched roof structure, blends in beautifully with the landscape. Yeah. You come inside and it's a different world, Matt. Different world.
OK. I'm going to lift your archway up and you tell me when.
Well, we might as well use every single square millimetre of space we've got. Go on.
Is that it?
That's it. I think that's it. And look at that as a space. I mean, come on. That archway running all the way through the entire caravan. Doesn't get much better than that, honestly. Come on.
Oh, yeah, I must confess.
It's beautiful. Have you just used your, like, Jedi powers to make that just hang there?
I don't know how it's hanging. It's genuinely no idea.
I just hope the Force will be with us for the rest of the build. Inspiration for our small space pioneers usually comes from one of two places. For some, it starts with an unusual structure. But for our next build, it started with the location.
Come on. Yep, yep, come on.
Beef farmer Stuart lives with his wife Charlotte and their young daughter Annie in North Devon.
We're a family-run farm, but we've got to do different things to survive nowadays, unfortunately. So it's a case of keeping the family farm going.
With the need to diversify to generate more income for the farm, Stuart has hatched an ambitious plan that harks back to his childhood.
The dream is to have a really cool cabin and people can come and stay. Since I was a young boy, trying to make tree houses was kind of just taking a pinch of that and making it reality, really.
He loves an idea and, yeah, quite a lot of them don't get much further than his head. But I think this is going to be one that hopefully will turn into something amazing.
The inspiration for the build came from a particular place on the farm.
It's too steep to farm, we can only graze it. So we thought it'd be a cool and idyllic, quiet spot for people to come and stay. You see owls swooping in and out, and it's just a wildlife gem, really.
So that's going to be the big window facing down there and out that way.
Stuart has a budget of £20,000, but he has some cunning ideas about how to cut costs on materials.
We have actually milled some trees that were felled last year, so we're actually going to be using some of the materials which are literally two or three fields away.
Stuart's hilltop cabin will capitalise on its stunning location. Surrounded by decking, at the front will be a giant picture window, perfect for owl watching. Downstairs will be a seating area complete with log burner, plus a kitchenette and compact bathroom in the corner. Upstairs in the mezzanine will be a cosy bedroom with enough room for two.
Pretty daunting, really, because it's a big responsibility. You know, we're committed. We've got to pull it all out now.
The first task is to build solid foundations on which to put the cabin. Not easy on such a steep incline.
Like the Island Games, isn't it?
Since this is Stuart's first ever building project, he's enlisted the expert help of Dad Ashley.
So on top of these supports, this is where our decking's going to go. This is the main part, getting the entire floor level, so our cabin's level.
But ensuring an even surface on a hillside is no mean feat.
Right, get the level, see if that's right.
That's level. It's only a plank of wood, but we can visualise a bit more now. Next step is getting the decking completed, and then we know where we're going from then.
5 weeks into the project, the decking is now complete, and today Stuart is starting on the main frame, with the help of a couple of mates from football.
We've got Shawnee and Davies here just to start the base of the structure and sort any wonkiness out that me and the old man did with the decking.
But are Stuart's levels really up to scratch?
If we put the football there, it should just stay there, shouldn't it?
Hang on, you must.
Hang on, come back. Level. There's a little dodge in there.
With the base nice and flat, the walls can now go up.
This is for the front of the actual cabin itself, making sure that got enough spaces for the windows and the door.
Four weeks later, and Stuart's hillside cabin is standing proud.
We've got the structure up, and we've insulated pretty much all of it. Roof is on. As you can see, it looks pretty awesome.
Being so close to the woodland, Stuart's always on the lookout for local materials to use.
We're going to use the twisted ivy as a handrail in the cabin as we go up the stairs. Look at that. Nice twists in there.
And there's plenty more local wood where that came from.
It was actually a dead tree which was standing, and we thought it would look pretty awesome as a support from the mezzanine.
Left a bit in there.
With those black packers and all?
Yeah.
How's it fit?
Looks good, doesn't it?
That's not bad, is it, eh?
Let's just hope the rest of Stuart's ideas hold up. From old grain silos to shepherd's huts. Over the years, our small space pioneers have tried it all. But what happens if you mix and match?
I'm in Rutland to see what happens when you take three grain silos and four shepherd's huts and merge them all together into one super-sized glamping pod. Now that is truly something. I've seen converted grain silos and converted shepherd's huts, but together, that's unique.
There's a wetland wildlife pond, large deck, and wood-fired hot tub before you even go inside. Oh, my word.
I was not expecting that. Look how beautiful this is. You've got the wonderful conical roof going up to a circular skylight, finished in a beautiful warm plywood. And look at the floor. Reuse of a sports hall floor from an army base. Brilliant. So how do you bring a rectangular shepherd's hut together with a circular grain silo? Well, you put in a very simple, elegant piece of glass.
Three of the shepherd's huts are simply styled bedrooms.
A quintessential country cottage look. It's beautiful. Lovely vaulted ceiling. And then they needed to create a very clever link between grain silo to grain silo. And this is a much bigger glazed link. It's like a little mini room where you can just sit on a beautiful bench and admire the view. Now, talk about the kitchen being the heart of the home. This is absolutely bang in the middle of the plan. And what's genius is that for splashbacks, where they've actually created the new windows and the old grain silo, they've taken the corrugated metal that they've cut out and put it there. I love that.
The kitchen, living room and bedrooms might all be stylish, but the masterpiece is in the final silo.
What a grand entrance. It's the most fantastic way of walking in to a beautiful space that just has a bath in it. And then, to make this bathroom even more grand, they've taken a beautiful hand-carved fireplace from a manor house and put it in the bathroom. A stunning feature in the space. But just when I thought I'd seen it all, there's one final touch which makes this space a little bit different. Absolutely ridiculous. Who would think about putting a glitter ball in the middle of a Georgian-inspired bathroom inside an agricultural grain silo?
This just goes to show that with a little imagination, even the most run-of-the-mill structures can be reinvented as five-star getaways. Something that's not getting away soon, however, is the double-decker in Buckinghamshire. So I'm back to give DIY fans Martin and Tracy a hand.
Hello, hello.
Hello.
How are you getting on? You all right?
Yeah.
More panel fitting today. Is this the plan?
Yeah. We've got to get these three in today.
Excellent. And where should we start?
These panels on. Luckily, it's very easy.
So this one needs to overlap the next one, yeah?
Right, come to me a bit.
Yeah.
A bit more.
More.
That's it. Just pull it up a bit.
That's actually trickier than I thought. I'm not moving now until you put some fixings in there.
Hang on, I thought Martin said this was easy.
Don't hit my head. Whatever you do. I mean, it might knock some sense into me, but just do it gently.
That's it. You can let go.
God, thank God for that. Well, I'll tell you what, when they're all fitted and it's all painted, it's going to look incredible.
Yeah.
Keep pushing.
We will.
And I'll see you at the end.
You will.
Take care.
Bye-bye.
2 months into the build, Martin and Tracy's double-decker bus has been fully repanelled, and Martin has been painstakingly giving it a new look.
You can't spray this paint on or anything. So the whole lot's been painted by hand like this. And that's taken about a week of solid painting. Right, Tracy, you around? Outside the bus, painted, finished.
Pretty much perfect. I'd say colours are beautiful, aren't they? Really nice.
The next job is replacing the sails on all 44 windows. But there's a problem.
It's a bit bright.
It's awful. It's really awful. We can't do that. It's just not right. It's not the right colour. It's such a small thing, but it looks so bad.
It won't be that small when you put it on so many windows.
I know, exactly. Yeah.
It turns out the seals the couple have chosen are the wrong colour to match the paintwork.
Until we can get the window seals in, obviously we can't get the windows in, it's not watertight, so we can't move it out from the barn where we're doing most of the work at the moment, but it's just massively set us back.
And there's the first floor.
While Martin and Tracy wait for the new window sills, they move on to solving another problem, creating a tall enough shower room.
We could drop the shower tray down into the floor.
Right, we're sure we want to do this. Cut a hole in the floor of the bus.
By lowering the shower tray, the couple hope to gain valuable headroom.
It is just one square.
It's one square, and it'll make such a difference to our shower.
Yeah. I can kind of picture it now. I think it's going to be all right.
Just 4 weeks later, there's good news. The new window sills have arrived.
Tracy was right, getting these changed for the right green, because when you compare them with the old green now, this does look a lot nicer. One window in.
But with 43 more to go and the interior to do, there's still many more stops on this bus's journey to its final destination. This series, I'm seeking architectural inspiration from one of the most fascinating countries I've visited. Israel. And you can't come to Israel without visiting Jerusalem, one of the holiest cities in the world. But I'm not here to visit a sacred religious site. I'm here for something surprising.
When you think of a YMCA, you imagine fairly basic, affordable accommodation in an unremarkable building, but not in Jerusalem. Just look at that.
A city all too often divided, this building was designed to embrace all nationalities and religions, which you can see reflected in the architecture.
It's a whole mix of lots of different architectural styles. You've got Byzantine, you've got Romanesque arches, you've got little Gothic touches. And when you look closely, there's even 1930s metal-framed industrial windows and a tower that has touches of Art Deco. And that's because this building was designed by the same architect as the Empire State Building. But where the Empire State Building was built in a record 1 year and 45 days, this building is so ornate, it took 7 years. Just look at this for an entrance lobby and hallway. It's so decorative. And this building is all about being multi-faith, multicultural. And standing in here, you could be in a church, a mosque, a synagogue. Now, I've been to many hostels and YMCAs over the years, and they have spaces where people gather and come together. But unfortunately, they're often drab and uninspiring. Not here.
Beyond the lobby, there's an incredible auditorium, lavished with the same level of intricate detail.
Just look at this. It's breathtakingly beautiful.
But this building's greatest architectural achievement is the stunning 152-foot bell tower.
When you get to the top of the tower, look at these, they're amazing. 35 bells, collectively weighing well over 3 tons, and they were made by Gillett and Johnston in Croydon, in England, in 1931. And if I've got my timings right, they should be ringing just about. For a city that's so often described as being divided along religious lines, this is a building that's all about being multicultural, open to all faiths. And that means it's open-armed and welcoming for everyone.
He might not be staying at the YMCA, but one young man who's picked his build-up off the ground is Farmer Stewart in North Devon. Today, he's starting on the internal cladding.
I think I'm going to scorch the wood itself, so it brings out the nice grains and the knots. There we go. So basically, I've just made a little arrow to keep him with our cabin theme.
although it's taken shape, there's still a lot of work to do, so quite a few late nights.
And a few months later, it's time for me to see if Stuart has pulled off his childhood treehouse dream.
Now, some people build amazing spaces for their families, for holidays, memories, and fun. But for Stuart, his project was much more than that. He hoped that his build could diversify his dad's beef business. So you could say he bet the family farm on it. Stuart, how are you doing?
Hi, George, nice to meet you.
This is a beautiful spot.
Perched high up on a steep hill, surrounded by decking, is the most incredible wooden haven.
It's stunning. In a lot of the build, you've used materials from the farm.
That's
right.
Tell
me about that.
Yeah, so we've tried to be resourceful as much as we can to save costs.
So all these posts on the outside, all of that is from the farm?
Yeah, all of them.
Can we go inside and have a look?
Let's go.
Come on. I tell you what, that is well steep, isn't it?
It's a workout.
And that's a nice touch.
Cool, isn't it?
The nice little cute little owl eyes on there.
Yeah, nice little owl theme throughout the cabin.
Oh, that's beautiful when you get up to this level, isn't it?
Isn't it just?
Can I have a look inside?
Yeah, sure. Let's go.
I'll tell you what, Stuart, that is fantastic.
Stuart has created an idyllic rustic retreat packed to the rafters with locally sourced wood. From the pallet wood cladding to the bedroom tucked up behind a barn door in the mezzanine, it's a slice of rural heaven on a hilltop in North Devon.
So this is all very cosy and snug and more wall than window.
Yeah.
And then bang.
Yeah.
You've got that.
Yep. Nice viewing spot.
It is stunning. And I have to say, mate, from a space planning point of view, you've smashed it. I mean, that's got to be one of the smallest kitchens I've ever seen. Sink, hob, bit of storage, done.
Stuart has also been savvy with his compact bathroom tucked away under the mezzanine.
Just tell me where you got everything from.
Well, basically, that tree there is an oak tree, which is from across the river.
Beautiful, isn't it?
It's lush, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, also the fact that it's right in the middle of the space makes a real feature of it. And all of this?
That's beech as well from the farm we had milled, and the spindles as well.
So all of that is from your farm?
All of that, yeah.
You are building from the land around you.
Yeah, sustainable, and it's definitely saved our cost as well.
I love the fact you've even scorched a little owl onto the pallet timber at the back there.
Yeah, he's fun, isn't he?
He's so cute. Fantastic, mate. A wonderful use of natural materials.
Pulled it off.
You definitely have.
But is Stuart proud of his owl-inspired cabin?
How do you feel about this, sitting here now, after you've built this?
I think it's bloody awesome. All that hard work and effort and plans, and there it is.
Well, I take my hat off to you, because you've never done this before, have you?
No, not at all. Jumped in the deep end with a few local, knowledgeable, helpful hands, and, a lot of hard graft.
And your budget to build this was 20,000 quid?
Yeah, I was aiming for 20,000, but we've crept into about 26 and a half. So not massively over.
And obviously, this is a structure that's got to earn its keep.
Yeah, 100%. We've diversified on the farm. This is going to be an extra bit of income for the farm to keep it going for generations and onwards.
Stuart hasn't just created a stunning build. It's a wise financial move for the future of the farm, perhaps even as wise as one of his owls.
Now, I love the fact that this build not only sits on the family farm, but some of it is also made from the farm itself. A farm that, now thanks in part to this beautiful, cosy cabin, should be secure for Stuart's children and their children to come.
You want a little bit?
Oh!
Oh.
the basic structure of my handcrafted caravan well underway, I'm looking ahead to its external appearance. So I've brought Max to the incredible Coniston Warner.
So, Max, welcome to the beautiful Lake District.
Stunning, isn't it?
Absolutely gorgeous.
What better inspiration for my caravan colour scheme than these beautiful surroundings?
So today, I think I've kind of got this fairly clever approach about how we might be able to find the right colours. Come on, let's have a look.
I've arranged to meet a couple of lads who use landscape photography to create bespoke colour palettes for designers.
Max, meet Alex and Cameron.
Nice to meet both.
Boys, just tell them about what you do and how you do it.
Yeah, so Cameron's a photographer and I'm a designer, and we were driving through Scotland one day and we just saw these beautiful colours go past. And we realised that if we were to use Cameron's photographs and then using Photoshop to then draw these colours out, we could then share them with everyone.
The result, a magazine of sensational images that double up as carefully curated swatches by pinpointing specific pixels in the pictures.
See the tiny little squares?
Oh, yeah.
Just picked off the colours and then laid them out. So if you want to design something that's absolutely unique to that landscape and want to be inspired by those exact colours, these boys can do it.
It's quite clever, that. It's like adding science to art.
Now it's our turn.
So we're going to take some shots and we'll meet you at the pub later. Is that all right?
You'll see you at the pub.
Fantastic. Right. Thank you very much. So, mate, that's a nice camera you've got there now, you know? Right, OK.
I tell you what, though, when you start looking at all the different colours in that shot, blue, green, brown, stone, yeah, I think they're onto something, you know?
We're trying to capture a single image that has all the colours we'll need for the caravan design.
I'm quite obsessed with that pink in the clouds.
When you start to look for colour, not composition, you realise how many different shades and tones there are in any one shot.
Why don't we just get in the woods a bit? We've done a bit down the lake, but I think let's dip into this. Look at the light in here. That's beautiful.
It's quite addictive, this. I'm quite enjoying it. Oh, here it is, holly. Holly green, done.
Can you, like, compose your shots a bit better? You can't just wander around doing that.
Of course you can.
You want.
Grass green, fir green, holly green.
So that's it, just colour, doesn't matter. It doesn't matter about the art of taking a beautiful photograph.
I am listening. Moss green, done. Come on, got a caravan to build.
Time to get Max and his novel approach to creativity to the pub, where the boys will pick the best picture to generate our colour palette.
How'd you go on?
Well, I'll let you be the judge of that, to be honest with you. There's one camera.
That
is such a bad shot.
That speaks to me, that does. That says greenery.
There's a lot of greens here at the moment.
Yeah.
There you go. It's one of mine. So what are you boys thinking?
We're liking your one.
Thank you very much, sir.
Sorry.
Sorry, mate.
Now we've got the picture, time to pick out the colours.
So let's start with the centre hue, which is going to really be kind of the anchor for the entire combination. We just use this little eyedropper to find different hues, different greens or blues that we like.
It's literally picking that tiny, tiny, tiny little pixel.
I mean, colours our eyes almost don't see and recognise, aren't they?
Look at that. See, I would never have seen that green in there. That's beautiful, that.
We're trying to find colours that are going to complement it or kind of build from it.
OK.
So if we wanted to then pick one of the hues from the trees that are slightly darker shade, so that the browns that you might not expect to see in kind of forests.
Ooh, look
again,
at that.
And then to brighten the whole range, just go for something like the sky, just to add a little bit of space to the palette and let it breathe a bit.
It's a beautiful palette that just complements each other. That's when you realise that Mother Nature is a brilliant designer.
Exactly.
She's probably the best out there, isn't she, really?
Well, top three.
Boys, that was fantastic. Honestly, brilliant. Thank you so much. What a wonderful approach to selecting colours from the natural landscape. And I think we might have nailed the colours.
I can't think of a better way to paint my caravan than with Mother Nature herself. From the muted greens of the Lake District to a bright green bus in Bucks, Martin and Tracy are putting the finishing touches to their project.
Yeah, just need to tidy up this end. I can do that.
It's been a long time of grafting on this, so...
Yeah. Looking forward to getting things actually done and finished.
It's been 4 months since I last visited, so I'm back to see if their double-decker conversion is just the ticket.
Now, Martin and Tracy hoped that their bus would give them the extra space they need for everyone to have a more peaceful way of life. Now, I hope you've checked the timetable, because this is one bus you're not going to want to miss. Good morning.
Morning.
How are you?
Very good, thank
you. Well, you should be unbelievably happy, because that is off the scale brilliant.
We're really pleased with it.
Yeah.
It looks absolutely fantastic. The colour's brilliant, isn't it?
That's the original colour, hand-painted with a brush.
And tell me about the sign on the top.
So that was its first journey. When it's brand new, that's what it had at the front.
Well, the outside looks great. Can we have a look inside?
Absolutely, let's go.
Before, the downstairs of this bus smacked of dated 70s public transport.
Oh, that is fantastic.
But now, it's a stylish, spacious living area with high-end finishes and all the mod cons.
I'm actually quite blown away, to be honest with you. You've just absolutely smashed it out of the park. And you've got a great kitchen area, loads of prep space. And what about your sink? It's massive.
It is large, and that was my choice.
That sink, I must have lifted in about, I had lost count how many times, and I think it was just getting heavier and heavier every time.
I'll tell you what, I love your shower room. You've even dropped the shower tray in.
Yeah.
Just to get an extra little bit of headroom.
Yeah.
Beautiful, I love these tiles. You've gone all posh. It's a proper posh bus, isn't it?
Yeah, certainly posher than our old caravan.
At the back, Martin and Tracy have kept the old seats, but given them a luxurious facelift.
And I have to say, your seats have been beautifully upholstered. Is that the same detailing that was on the original seat?
It is, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, my God, it's beautiful. But what a great space and a fantastic layout. It's got everything. Mm. Absolutely everything. Can we have a look upstairs?
Yeah.
Yeah, let's do it. Is the bell working?
Yes.
Yes! That brings back memories.
Upstairs, gone are the rows of tired old seats. Now it's bright and airy, with room to relax and even host sleepovers for six.
You've got two bunks. They're really beautiful and look super cosy, actually. And then you come through to the master bedroom, the double bed at the back.
Yeah.
My kids would love this. They must be chuffed to bits.
Really pleased.
And 360-degree elevated views. I mean, happy days.
And Martin and Tracy have even made a space for me.
Front row, top deck. I love sitting here. It's my little spot. Just keeping these up front, it's like having a little mini snug seating area on the upper level, sitting here with a cup of tea, read a book. So is that your bus?
It is our actual bus, yeah.
You've become proper bus geeks now, haven't you?
Yeah.
So how did these born-again bus fanatics find the journey?
So, be honest, what was the process like building this?
Painful at times.
Jobs did seem to take longer than we expected all the time.
Believe you me, it didn't take a long time. It might have felt like a long time to you two, but it's been super quick.
Yeah.
And I take my hat off to both of you for being able to do it at that level that quickly. And budget, your original budget, I think was around £10,000.
Yeah.
Kind of.
We're well over that.
How far?
We're about somewhere between 20 and 21,000.
Okay. But it's worth its weight in gold, isn't it, when it comes to quality of life?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That is what it's about, really.
And life-changing for you and the kids.
Relax and enjoy it now, I think.
Yeah, we need to.
Absolutely. Well done.
Thank you
very much.
Wow. What do you think, guys?
Hola.
Straight in there.
They're so comfy, these beds are.
Really nice to have sleepovers. Four of them in here and then two of them in there.
Now, Martin and Tracy have not only created a space to get away from their cramped caravan, but they've also lovingly restored an old bus with what I think has got a fascinating history. And when you think about it, for a couple who have never done anything like this ever before, they've completely smashed it out of the park. They can now sit back, relax, and enjoy the ride.
I actually kind of did see this.
Next time...
Still works.
One woman creates a stunning tiny home from scratch.
Oh, Liberty, it's beautiful.
A teacher who's local for locomotives builds something inspirational.
Come and have a look. What do you think?
And I visit an Israeli kibbutz that's full of surprises.
Every desert village needs an R2-D2.
Before you take on your own small space project, you should seek independent planning advice and check with your local council.